very affirmative, isn't she? James, yes. nice to meet you. And
you too.
Very much looking forward to your new production of Dracula. What actually drove you to actually work on this on your own, write it yourself and yourself?
COVID.
Lockdown madness.
It was lockdown madness. It was COVID. I wanted to do something. I'd always wanted to kind of adapt something. And the more that, you know, friends who were in the West End particularly were struggling with COVID restrictions and everything else, it struck me that the simplest way forward would be a one-man show, because then, you know, it cut down the likelihood of not being able to perform. And that's how it started. I mean, you know, it grew from there, basically.
You first encountered Dracula as a young boy, but probably in a Hammer horror version, is that right?
Yes, absolutely, yeah. It was
Christopher Lee. Like most of us.
Yeah, I snuck down during I was staying with my nana, and they all went to bed. And, you know, I still remember I think it must have been about 8 or 9, and she sort of turned the television off because it came up, the big Hammer horror thing came up, and she went, oh, you can't watch that. And I was thinking, I wonder why not? You know, I just come down for, you know, to grab a biscuit. And she said, no, you can't watch that. So they went back up to bed, and I snuck down a bit later and just sat there watching it. And, you know, it was mesmerizing. And Hammer horror, I think, has always held a place ever since. You know, I could wax lyrical about the work of Michael Ripper, you know, appearing in all of those. So, yeah, great fondness for it, but not really the kind of the Dracula that Stoker intended.
When did you first read the actual book?
I read the book probably when I was about 14. I was on holiday with my parents, and I remember I got a copy of Edgar Allan Poe's Tales of Mystery and Imagination. It was in Yorkshire. I can't remember the exact village, but we'd gone on holiday for summer, and they had an honesty box outside, you know, with a pile of books and stuff. And I put sixpence in, bought Edgar Allan Poe and took it home. And I was mesmerized by that. So I went back to see if there was anything else, and they had Dracula. And that was the first time. It was a struggle. Don't get me wrong. It was a struggle to get through, because I'd never come across that kind of concurrent writing where everything happens at the same time. And, you know, your timelines are kind of all over. I think he was way ahead of his time in a lot of ways.
Yes. And of course, that's very complex to translate to a stage production. The fact that things happen concurrently.
Yeah. You've got to, you know, I had to make choices, and, you know, I wanted to try to tell the whole story, and, you know, an awful lot of productions concentrate on the end, because, you know, the book itself would take about 14 hours if you read it. You know, if it's, you know, I have a couple of audio versions, and they take about 13, 14 hours. So I wanted to try to find a way to tell the whole story. And the way that I'm doing it is to present it as myself telling the aftermath of an aborted TV documentary series, which had found the kind of the original Stoker lost handwritten version. Which is all those kind of things always fascinate me. You know, the fact that I think it's Paul Allen who owns the original typed version, which was in a barn in Pennsylvania, and he bought that. And just the idea that, you know, something could be, you know, out there written, which isn't the one we know. So it takes that form. I start to present a series, something happens within the series which cancels the series, and I'm so taken with it that I continue to investigate it. So it's kind of the effect that it has, and you get to tell the story that way.
So have you called upon yourself to actually play all the different roles? I mean, there are, 16 characters at least?
Yeah. The main protagonists, more so than any others. The others are flavours. You know, there's Arthur Bloxham, who delivers the crates to Carfax. There's the Captain Donaldson of the ship, you know, the ship that takes Dracula back to the Black Sea. So it's mainly the main protagonists, you know, Seward, Van Helsing, Mina, Harker, Quincy. You know, they're the ones who feature most. But, yeah, it's... everybody asks as well, do you play Dracula? And I do and I don't, you know, which is kind of my way of saying, you know, wait and see. Yeah.
Well, there have been so many incarnations of Dracula on stage and in film and on television. I mean, is there one that you've particularly enjoyed?
Jack Palance, way back, BBC. I think it was about 73, 74. It was something so I still recall, and that's why I was desperate to get that just that little reference in. I still recall shuddering, and I don't shudder often, but when he came out of his window and started to go down the wall head first, you know, that was kind of that was the most striking one for me that that resonates. I think Gary Oldman did a terrific job. You know, apart from the Bett Lynch hairstyle that they put
on. That was very interesting, the Bett Lynch hairstyle.
It was, wasn't it?
Of course, you must know really well because you were in, well, over 100 episodes of Coronation Street.
Yeah, but never worked with Bett Lynch, weirdly. I never did. But yeah, I mean, it was renowned at the time. And that's, you know, so for me, suddenly seeing Gary Oldman with that, it was like a cross between the Queen of Hearts and Bett Lynch. And I think, but I think that was, for me, again, that was as close to the actual story as you can get. You know, I think they did that terrifically. So, and it was so sumptuous and so sort of alluring. But then you look at the old, you know, the Nosferatus, and they are, you know, that that's kind of how I've always pictured Dracula as being, you know, not this necessarily. He is seductive, but in a way that is not, you know, sort of filmically seductive. I think it's more a case of, you know, it's like people talk about being bit by vampire bats and they have no recollection of it. You know, they wake up in the morning and they've got blood all over the sheets, but they don't realize what's happening. And I think there's that kind of thing that Stoker was aiming at. And of course, this thing, which I'd fallen for, you know, and I reference in the play as well, that we all think that, you know, vampires can't come out during the daytime. And they can, you know, they actually can. So,
it's, you know, myth, it's and just, legend mixed.
It's myth and legend mixed with Hollywood, you know, yes. Hollywood-like like a bit of thing. Or if you're in the Hammer Horror, it's all shot day for night.
You've done an awful lot of very different things over the years. Mm. I mean, your name, Gaddas, rhymes with perhaps how you're seen or perceived in a lot of TV productions as a badass.
it's true, actually. I do remember, you know, back at theatre school, I think it started because we were doing a production of Romeo and Juliet. And I always remember the director of that, he cast it and he said, right, so Charmian, you'll be playing Juliet because you look very Italian. And Chris, you'll be playing Romeo because you're the most handsome. And James, you look vicious, so you'll be playing Tybalt. And nothing's changed.
English actors are so often cast by Hollywood as baddies, aren't they?
We are, because I think there is the baddies always get the best roles. I mean, there's a charm to, I always said, you know, I played Romeo in Southampton in 83, I think. And having played Tybalt, you know, people said, it must be nicer to play Romeo. And I'm like, absolutely not. Tybalt, you know, 14 lines, 3 sword fights, dead at the interval. It's a gift, you know, so. Hanging around for the curtain call, never good. But yeah, I think we play baddies well. I think we have that. I think there's an art to playing a baddie without it just being, unless the role calls for a stone cold psychopath. I think we do it with a sort of Alan Rickman and Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves, you know, it's the just, yeah, absolutely. That's just the thing, you know, Alan Rickman in anything really, but, you know, that ability to kind of, isn't it? Yeah. So I think that's where it comes from. But yeah, I mean, I've enjoyed playing baddies, you know, it's certainly not been anything unpleasant. You know, I think I prefer in a lot of ways to play them.
To be a little bit evil. Now you're coming to Brighton Theatre Royal, which is much loved in the town, but it's also notoriously a small stage. Is your production a nice compact production?
Very compact, you know, because again, as I say, we had to work out if, you know, when we started talking about touring it, you know, there was this thought, because it's not only the actor, obviously, it's also, you know, what happens if we tour 5, 6, 7 crew and one of them goes down with COVID, and then that becomes difficult. So, you know, we made the decision to bring in the people that we've got involved in the, you know, the direction and the illusions and the sound and everything else. But the stage management would be one person who tours it with me. And then the crew at the various theatres do the get-ins, the get-outs. And it's worked well, but that meant obviously that we, you know, being a one night show, we've got to put up a set and take it down on the same day. Yeah. So, you know, we are compact. Look out, we're here for you. Look out,
we're here for you. It's also, I mean, I go and see shows, and sometimes I think the trickery and the technology has overtaken the performance.
Absolutely.
And I go in and I see a production, and it's really, it's not stripped back. It's just going back to traditional stagecraft.
Sure. Yeah.
And when I see that, I come out with a sort of glow because it's not been done by computers.
No.
It works so well. It has more atmosphere. It's theatre at its best for me.
I think so. I think you can. And one of the things that I was really sort of chuffed with in this is years ago when I was 11, I met Jeremy Swift. We were at school together, and you know, we've been close ever since. And you know, he's in Ted Lasso, he's Emmy nominated, and all of that kind of stuff. And we were walking in Kenwood when I sort of started to write this and everything. And he said, "Would you like me to write some music?" And Jez does music, you know, as a sideline. He loves to write and everything else. And I think his soundscape is terrific. So that lifts, you know, your sort of time on stage. It's almost like having somebody alongside you, because you've got this wonderful kind of sound, which also adds to, you know, the thing. And broadly speaking, you know, that would, again, you could have an actor with somebody with some. I saw a show called Cruise in the West End just as COVID was kind of coming out. I think Nika Burns put it on at one of the smaller theatres. It was, again, it was an actor who'd written a show during lockdown, a young guy who'd written a show about the early AIDS pandemic and how he was working the phone lines. And somebody had called in and said, "You don't know anything, what it was like back then in the 80s. And he'd taken that conversation, he'd written a show, and he had a musician on stage playing, you know, the sort of the tunes of the time, you know, that heavy sort of dance music and everything else. And it just gives it so much power. We forget how strong music can be.
Absolutely. And on the subject of music, you've appeared in quite a few musicals as well. Oh, I saw you in Billy Elliot.
Did you?
Yes, I did.
Wow. 2008.
Yes.
Which is
some time ago now.
Incredible show. Weirdly, that was, you know, if my music teacher back at Bristol had, you know, I'd said, "Yeah, I'm going to do a few musicals," she would have laughed herself silly. But it's, again, it's that thing, you know, I think I'd gone in for Billy after Bad Girls. And I was, you know, Geordie, kind of, well, Northeast. So that fit the role. And then from then on, it just kind of snowballed from there. So you do Spamalot, you do Mamma Mia, you do The Girls. And I think there's a market for actors of my age who can carry a tune in musicals that I couldn't do, you know, Les Mis or something like that, where you've got these incredible voices that are sung through. But I do think that, you know, sort of musicals that rely on a story and a certain amount of acting and everything else, and it's more about that than anything else, you know, I think there are an awful lot of times for us, and it's fun. You know, I've never had so much fun as doing Spamalot, you know, running around. It's a great show. Well, I say that. No, the most incredible feeling on stage, really sad for a guy of my age, is coming on at the end of Mamma Mia in Lycra and platform boots and watching the crowd go wild as the dads come. It's the nearest a guy of my age could get to being a rock star. So, yeah, it's fun.
I think the difference between what you're talking about here is the fact that as an actor with a decent voice, you can actually act a song.
Mm.
So the song progresses the narrative in character, whereas a lot of new musicals, you have people coming on and they've been cast because they can sing and they can dance.
Sure. But
they're just singing a lyric. They're not acting the story through.
Yeah. And I think that's why certain people, you know, Alfie, Bo and people like that, just they get you every time, you know. Mm. You feel that with them. And, you know, it's the one thing I'm always jealous of is, you know, people who can open their voice and sing. Just incredibly, you know, it was, you know, the numbers of times I've been to see shows and think, I would love to play that part, but I never could. You know, it would be as a result of doing musicals, which I'd never considered doing when I was at theatre school. You know, you just imagine you're going to do certain things and then you end up doing a musical for the first time and you really start to appreciate the work that's done. You know, I, like, for example, I didn't know, for my sins, I didn't know what a swing was. You know, the swings who cover every single part in the show, in the ensemble, not the understudies. They cover the ensemble and they never miss a beat. So they're covering 8, 9, 10 people. They go on, they have to dance in opposition to what they're doing and they never miss a beat. I had no idea, you know, so learning just how important swings are, you know, because people had said to me, oh, they're too, you know, you were like, why are they not in these? They're too valuable, you know, we can't take them out of being a swing. So all of those nuances of musicals that you think are so simple. The only downside, of course, is that, you know, you go into the West End and you can't beat the congestion charge because you've got to warm up in, you know, sort of a limber and an actual vocal warm up singing wise, as opposed to just, you know, a voice workout in your dressing room. So, yeah.
How many different Billies did you actually have to perform with?
I had 9 in total. And
quite a lot, and you've also got to learn how to work that role with the different young actors.
It is, and they were all different. You know, some of them were ballet Billies. You know, they'd do the ballet. Others were street Billies. They'd do more sort of modern dance. But it was the most moving moment for me on stage at the end when I finished, when I did my last show, and all of my Billies came on for the curtain call. You know, and it was, you know, I go with the drop of a hat anyway. So, you know, but yeah, I mean, it was, they are incredible. They sing, they dance, they act, they're on stage for 2 hours. They learn the accent. You know, we had American Billies who were doing that. We had one, Leon Cook, who I've worked with since in Mamma Mia, you know, now he's older. He was in covering, I think he was second reserve Billy that night because they always have 3 in case of accident. And 2 of the Michaels went down and they were stuck at, you know, just before we were about to start because we didn't have a Michael and they were trying to get one in, but we'd never get there for curtain call, for a curtain up. And they said to Leon, could you do Michael? Now, he'd never rehearsed it. He'd never played it. He went on as Michael. So he's doing all of the tap and everything the other way around to what he would normally do.
Yeah.
And didn't miss a thing. And absolutely, I just sat there thinking, it is, it's incredible, you know. But you've got no fear at that age. Yeah.
Are there any roles that you really still want to play?
There's loads, I'm sure. I'd love to play the Scottish King. I'd love to play him one day. You know, I just have this had this wonderful image of I'd always wanted to do it almost like a modern piece and having huge doors open at the back with the returning from war with big backlit lights to the opening bars of Wild Boys by Duran Duran. I always thought that would be a great start. I'd love to do Daffy and Chorus of Disapproval. I did that years ago with Colin Blakely when I played Crispin in that. And I think that's a lovely piece. Yeah, it really is. And other than that, you know, I'd love to do some new writing.
And is there anything lined up when you finish Dracula?
No, not at the moment. I was toying with the idea of doing a one-man version of the Three Musketeers, which would be fun.
That's a but complex concept.
It is, but you know,
I need to get my head around that one.
No, I did consider doing it originally, but I'm now thinking of doing it as a two-hander, just so you can get better sword fights in. but doing it because D'Artagnan died at the age of 60 at the Battle of Maastricht. And in my version, it would be a case of a young writer coming to him on the night of the battle and saying he wanted to write his story. And D'Artagnan, so I'd play all the other parts and the young guy would end up playing D'Artagnan. I think that could be interesting. But in terms of actual work, no, I mean, but then I've never been somebody who tends to have stuff lined up. You know, I've just kind of drifted from job
and
to
yet,
job.
And yet, looking at your CV, you've hardly ever been out of work.
I'm touching wood here. I've been very lucky, you know, and I know actors say, oh, it's lucky, but I have been lucky. You know, I've played an awful lot of stuff, different genres, different types. And yeah, I've tended to not be out of work. But as I say, I've rarely been able to say, yes, I'm going from here to here and this and that. But again, that's, in a way, that's part of the joy. That's part of the excitement, because if you knew what you were doing for the next 5 years and it was all mapped out, I don't know. I don't think that would be as much fun.
Well, listen, thank you very much for talking to me today. I'm very Absolute much pleasure. Looking forward to seeing the show cool. next week when it hits Brighton on Monday. How long is the tour?
Till April the 9th, we finish.
Okay. Not too much longer to go.
Not too much longer. No.
You won't be that no. exhausted.
Hopefully listen, not.
Good luck with the rest of the tour and looking forward thank to you. Seeing you next week. And thank you for Brilliant. Joining the latest television.
Thank you. We're here for you.